There follows 24 hours of intensive civilian and diplomatic activity, and the nation lines up behind the president.
I'd hate like heck to see us go to war, but if it's necessary to prevent a nuclear war, I think the action has to be taken at this time.
Well, I think it's high time we stopped Russia from having things her own way.
We only have a few more months to go on reserves, and I just hope they don't grab me, that's all.
I know that some action should be taken, but he's going to have to tread very lightly, short of war.
I think it's gone beyond the stage of whether or not we support the president or we don't support him. It's way past that.
Suddenly, the idea of civil defense no longer seems either useless or foolish. Suddenly, millions of Americans are asking one question. How can I make my family safe? Suddenly, it seems very important to have adequate supplies in every home. In some parts of the country, supermarket shelves are stripped bare. Yet if the worst had come, most of these second thoughts would have been too late. Across the nation, local government authorities and civil defense organizations step up the pace of stocking their community fallout shelters with essential supplies. In a world in which no family is beyond the range of nuclear warheads, civil defense cannot be a sometime thing. It is all the time, or it is no defense at all. At the United Nations, Ambassador Stevenson takes America's case to the world. He asks Russia's ambassador,
"Do you, Ambassador Zorin, deny that the USSR has placed and is placing medium and intermediate range missiles and sites in Cuba? Yes or no?"
You will have your answer in due course.
I'm prepared to wait for my answer until hell freezes over, if that's your decision.
With support pouring in from the free world, President Kennedy signs the quarantine order. At the Pentagon, Secretary of Defense Robert McNamara prepares to enforce it.
I have taken the necessary steps to deploy our forces to be in a position to make effective the quarantine at 2 p.m. tomorrow, Greenwich time. That will be the equivalent of 10 a.m. Eastern Daylight Time. The forces under my command, that is to say under the command of the President, are ordered to interdict, subject to certain instructions contained in the proclamation, the delivery of offensive weapons and associated material to Cuba. Those are the instructions we've been given. Those are the instructions we will carry out.
Strategic Air Command B-52 bombers, already on a massive worldwide airborne alert, are now flying 24-hour missions. The round-the-clock missions are made possible by mid-air refueling. Before one B-52 leaves its airborne station, another is airborne to take its place. Air Defense Command interceptors and Tactical Air Command fighter and reconnaissance aircraft join Navy, Marine, and SAC to maintain watch on the 2,000 ships known to be in the Atlantic. No one is certain how many of them are headed for Cuba with cargoes of prohibited weapons. All that is sure is that within 24 hours, a confrontation between the searching forces of the United States and a Soviet vessel heading for Cuba must take place. The world awaits the outcome. Thursday, October 25th, the Navy intercepts the Soviet tanker Bucharest and allows her to proceed. On Friday, another encounter takes place at sea. A Soviet chartered vessel, the Marukla, is stopped, boarded, and inspected, then cleared to proceed to Cuba. Apparently, the Soviet vessels loaded with offensive weapons and prohibited materials are awaiting orders at sea or have turned back. The world breathes a little easier, but the crisis continues. Low-level reconnaissance planes at near treetop level surprise the Cuban anti-aircraft crews, catch them running for their guns, and report that work on the missile sites is still going forward at a feverish pace around the clock. The Kremlin stalls for time, but the White House makes clear that time is running out. All strategic air command bombers not on airborne alert are prepared to take off, combat ready within 15 minutes of scramble notice. The maximum force of anti-aircraft missiles is on 5 to 15 minute alert. At headquarters, North American Air Defense Command, everything airborne within hundreds of miles of our borders is brought under intensive surveillance. Men and women the world over hang on the news. No one can be sure that he and his family will still be alive at this time tomorrow. On Sunday morning, a message reaches the White House from Moscow. Press Secretary Salinger announces that Chairman Khrushchev has agreed to remove the missiles from Cuba and reads Mr. Kennedy's reply to the Soviet Premier. The president already has left the White House to attend services at his church. One week in October, perhaps the most frightening week the world has ever known, is over. There would be something special to be thankful for when Thanksgiving Day rolled around. War had not come during that fateful one week in October. It might never come, but it might. And there could be no letting down. Low-level surveillance over Cuba would verify the fact that missile sites had been dismantled. Soviet ships would be photographed carrying the missiles out of Cuba. There would be no question about the continued vigilance by America's armed forces. If any question remained, it would concern civilian Americans. Would they, too, remember this fateful week in October?